Hi everyone, today we will be discussing about combinatorial chemistry. Combinatorial chemistry comprises of chemical synthetic methods that make it possible to prepare a large number of compounds in a single process. So what is combinatorial chemistry? Combinatorial chemistry comprises chemical synthetic methods that make it possible to prepare a large number of compounds in a single process. So what is the difference between normal synthetic chemistry we perform in the lab and coming to combinatorial chemistry? So here in this case we prepare a large number of compounds in a single process, whereas in the laboratory we prepare a single compound in a single process. So that is the difference between combinatorial chemistry and normal lab chemistry or conventional chemistry or traditional chemistry. So here these compound libraries can be made as mixtures or set of individual compounds or chemical structures by the use of computer software. And how does this combinatorial chemistry be done? So this combinatorial chemistry utilizes the computer software to prepare compound libraries. The combinatorial chemistry utilizes computer software to design and synthesize compound libraries. You know what is a compound library? A compound library is nothing but it is a collection of information or the data regarding the chemical compounds. It is a collection of chemical compounds. So a library is nothing but a collection. So it is a collection of chemical compounds. So these compound libraries can be synthesized as mixtures or they can be prepared as individual compounds, set of individual compounds, by the utilization of computer resources, computer software. So this is nothing but synthetic chemistry in combination with utilization of computer software is a part of combinatorial chemistry. So quickly we'll go through combinatorial chemistry. So combinatorial chemistry comprises of chemical synthetic methods that make it possible to prepare a large number of compounds in a single process. You see, the number is very vast. It may change from 10 to thousands or even millions. And these compound libraries are generated utilizing computer software. Now, the combinatorial chemistry can be used for synthesis of small molecules and for peptides. So basically in the laboratory we generally perform organic chemical synthesis, but there are labs which perform synthesis of peptide chemistry. It is called as peptide chemistry. So this combinatorial chemistry is not just limited to synthesis of small molecules but also for synthesis of peptides. It requires chemists not to think in terms of synthesizing single well-characterized compounds but in terms of simultaneously synthesizing large populations of compounds. So in the conventional or traditional chemistry, we aim at synthesizing single compounds at a time and their characterization and their evaluation. But here in combinatorial approach, what we do is we try to synthesize a library of compounds and then proceed with the biological evaluation. So it is very much efficient in times of in relation to time. So we are saving time in order to synthesize a large number of compound library for proceeding for high throughput screening, that is for biological evaluation. So it saves time and it also helps in synthesis of diverse group of compounds which are very much structurally different. And now whenever high number of compounds have to be prepared for testing, this technique can be used. So when is combinatorial chemistry utilized? In order when we require large number of compounds for evaluation. So combinatorial chemistry together with molecular modeling, we have studied molecular modeling techniques which are helpful in the design and optimization of the drug. So combinatorial chemistry along with molecular modeling may be considered as powerful tools for the implementation in drug design. So combinatorial chemistry along with drug design along with molecular modeling will help us reduce time in the design and synthesis of new drug molecules. So it is very useful approach, combinatorial chemistry. And what is the principle of combinatorial chemistry? The basic principle of these studies is to prepare very large number of compounds and then to identify important or active compounds. First, what we do, we try to synthesize large number of compounds and then we segregate or identify important or active compounds from this library, and then we proceed for pharmacological activity study, and then we proceed for pharmacological activity study. So this is a complete principle involved with combinatorial chemistry. The basic principle of these studies is to prepare very large number of compounds, it's the first criteria, and then identify important or active components out of the library, that is the second criteria, and then after this we proceed for submission to pharmacological study for biological evaluation. So the whole principle involves synthesis, identification and evaluation. So in short, we can say this, we'll say that it aims at synthesis, identification. I can type over here, I'm typing over here, you can see synthesis, identification and biological evaluation. So this whole combinatorial chemistry depends on synthesis, that is large number of compounds, and identification of small number of active compounds, and then proceed for biological evaluation of the small number of identified hits or the lead compounds. And what is the basic concept of combinatorial chemistry? Combinatorial chemistry differs from traditional synthesis in view that it involves the simultaneous reaction of one set of compounds with second set of compounds to produce a set of products known as combinatorial library. The basic concept, what does it involve? It involves simultaneous reaction of one set of compounds. Suppose you have a one set of compounds and you are making them to react with the second set of compounds. So what happens? It undergoes various permutations and combinations to give a compound library which consists of large number of compounds. Suppose you have a set of compounds A, it has three compounds, and you have another set B, it has three compounds. The permutation and combination, it may give 9 compounds in the chemical library. So you are preparing a combinatorial library of compounds utilizing two sets of compounds. The basic concept involves simultaneous reaction of one set of compound with the second set of compounds to produce a combinatorial library of products used by use of various permutations and combinations. And now, formation of large number of compounds which are structurally different is very important to increase the chances of finding hits. When we are proceeding for drug design, we usually go for the search of structurally dissimilar compounds in order to find which scaffold is the best molecule for the design of a drug. So here in combinatorial chemistry, we can synthesize structurally different molecules so that the chances of finding the hit or the lead compound is increased. So it involves the combinatorial chemistry, it involves formation of number of compounds in one time, that is synthesis of number of compounds in one time. As you can see in figure 1 here, the conventional reaction you can write as A plus B gives AB combination. Now in combinatorial chemistry, you take A with 1 to N, the number may be 1 to N. The A set contains 1 to N compounds and B set contains 1 to N compounds. It is not 1 minus N, it is 1 to N, and the combination gives 1 to N to B 1 to N. So you are preparing a combinatorial library which consists of a very large number of compounds which ranges from 1 to N. So formation of number of compounds in one time, and then high throughput screening which gives effective substances. High throughput screening and after generation of compounds, see, you have three compounds in set A and three compounds in set B. Now when you go for synthesis, you get various combinations, that is 9 different compounds: A1B1, A1B2, A1B3, similarly A2B1, A2B2, A3B3, similarly A3B1, A2, A3B2 and A3B3. So this is the diverse set of compounds which have been synthesized by combinatorial chemistry. So from this, the actives can be identified and they can be evaluated for biological activity. So that is high throughput screening. And next, design of combinatorial chemistry. It involves design of combinatorial chemistry is of two types. It's not the synthesis, but it's just the design. This is the design of combinatorial chemistry. As you can see, the first one, it involves sequential attachment of building blocks. One is sequential attachment of building blocks. The another one is non-sequential attachment of building blocks using B as a template. You take anything, A, B, C or D, anything can be taken as a template, and then non-sequential attachment of building blocks using that template. So coming to the sequential attachment of building blocks, we start with A and then we add on B, then the compound we synthesize is AB, and then followed by linking of C, ABC followed by D to give the final compound ABCD. So you can see this is the sequential growth, this is the sequential attachment of building blocks. And coming to the non-sequential attachment, and as we said, the B here, for example, we take B as a template, so B should be common. So here what we do is we are trying to incorporate B in every attachment. See, when A reacts with B, it gives AB, and then AB reacts with C, the C is linking to B, the B is a template. So now we try to link D, so the D can be linked to B in many ways. So it can be directly to C, or it can be directly to B, or it can be directly to A. So here it is the sequential growth, whereas it is a non-sequential growth of building a molecule. So here the sequential A to B, B to A, B, C, and then followed by A, B, C, D, whereas here it is something like a N compound, and it is like an iso compound. Here you can see this is an N compound, this is an iso compound. So A when reacts with B, we get AB, and then followed by C, we get ABC, and then followed by D, we get the D can be linked at any point. Either it can be linked at C, it can be linked at B, or it can be linked at A. So we get three different molecules. So this is non-sequential attachment of building blocks. This is the design. We are talking about design of combinatorial chemistry. And coming to the combinatorial approach, the combinatorial approach has two phases. First one is creating chemical synthesis, that is chemical libraries, that is synthesis of chemical libraries, and followed by identification of active ingredients. First is creation or preparation or synthesis of chemical libraries, followed by identification of active ingredients. So now, what are these different strategies or techniques involved in the synthesis of compound library or chemical library? So here we go through it. Compound library or chemical library is a collection of chemicals regularly used in chemical industry and high throughput screening. As we said, library is nothing but it is a collection. And what is the collection? Chemical. So it is a chemical library. So it is a collection of chemicals which are regularly used in chemical industry and high throughput screening. High throughput screening is nothing but for biological evaluation. High throughput screening is nothing but identification followed by evaluation. Identification of actives and followed by their evaluation of the actives. High throughput screening. So each stored chemical has associated information such as chemical structure, physicochemical characteristics, purity, quantity of the compound. When we prepare a chemical library, for every compound in the library, we have their description, like what is their chemical structure, what are their physico-chemical characteristics, what is its purity, and what is the quantity of that compound synthesized, and how are these chemical libraries synthesized. So combinatorial chemistry has two basic techniques for creating chemical libraries. One is split and mix synthesis method, and the another one is parallel synthesis method. How are we synthesizing chemical libraries? By two techniques. One is split and mix. Splitting means separating, and mixing means combining. Splitting and mixing. And another method is parallel synthesis method. And what are they? We will be seeing one by one. And types of component combinatorial library. And before we go for the, okay, I shall remove this techniques for the synthesis and I'll incorporate it at the back of this topic. X. So here I paste it. Combinatorial chemistry synthetic strategies. How are these techniques employed? So first we'll discuss what are the types of component combinatorial library, and then followed by different techniques of preparing combinatorial library. So coming to the types of combinatorial library, one is scaffold based libraries and another one is backbone based library. The another one is backbone based libraries. So we'll discuss what are these scaffold based libraries and backbone based libraries. Definition: a library includes this library, the scaffold based library includes the core structure. The other day we were discussing what is this core structure. Suppose if you are given a drug moiety, the R group varies, R4, R3, R1, R2, these vary, but the scaffold remains the same. So in a diverse group of compounds, if the scaffold is the same, then we combine them to scaffold library. We include them in a common scaffold library. So that is this core structure, which is common for all the compounds of the library. Several single building blocks can consist of similar scaffold substitution, example amino acid and amino benzophenone. Here you can see the scaffold is benzodiazepine scaffold, and here the R groups are various alkylating agents, and this building block, as you can see, the part which has been cleared, it consists of amino acid part, and this building block consists of amino benzophenone. As you can see here in the right, the benzodiazepines can be synthesized from benzophenones, amino benzophenone. What is benzophenone? The phenyl with ketone and another phenyl. This is benzophenone, and this benzophenone has an amine substitution. So this is called as amino benzophenone. And here amino acid, as you can see, this is carboxyl group C double bond OOH. This is called as a bead. We'll be discussing about what are beads, but before that, if you remember, if you replace this bead with H, this becomes carboxyl group, and the alpha position you have an amine and there is an R group. So this is an amino acid. So the benzodiazepine can be synthesized from amino acid, or the benzodiazepine can be synthesized from amino benzophenone, or we can fuse amino acid with amino benzophenone to give benzodiazepine. So this first common scaffold is benzodiazepine, where the building blocks are amino acids and amino benzophenone. So these are included under scaffold based library. The scaffold is the same, the functional groups or the substituents will be varying, like A, B and C. These are the substituents or the functional groups, but the scaffold is the same. So this constitute scaffold based library. So library includes the core structure. What is the core structure? Benzodiazepine, which is common to all the compounds of the library. Several single building blocks can consist of similar scaffold substitutions, but the substitutions vary. Similar scaffold, but substitutions vary. Example: amino acid and amino benzophenone. And coming to the second type of library, it is backbone based library. As we have said the other day, we were discussing about the protein structure. In that we have said that the primary structure of the protein is nothing but a combination of several amino acids in a linear fashion. So that gives the primary structure of a protein, in which you can see that one amino acid combines with the amino acid to form a peptide bond. And what is a peptide bond? Peptide bond is nothing but an amide bond, that is NH C double bond O. NH associated with C double bond O, this is called as a peptide bond. So that peptide bond is the backbone of a protein. Peptide bond is a backbone of a protein. So now what is the backbone of a protein? Peptide bond. As you can see, this is NH CH2 C double bond O NH. So this is the peptide bond, NH C double bond O. So this backbone, this is considered as a backbone, and R groups may vary. R groups may vary. So if at all the backbone is the same for the design library, then it constitutes backbone based library. Example, nucleic acid, protein and carbohydrate. Carbohydrates have the same backbone, proteins have the same backbone, nucleic acid structures have the same backbone. So they have a common backbone with various substituents. See here, you are varying only the R group, but the backbone remains the same. So building block A amino acid and building block B different amino acid combined to give backbone based library AB. So these are the types of compound library. And what is the function of a compound library? Its function is optimization and identification of a lead, optimization and identification of a lead molecule, optimization and identification of a lead molecule. Example is in the process of drug discovery. In the process of drug discovery, what is the need for a combinatorial library? The only thing is optimization, identification, optimization of a hit or lead molecule in the process of drug discovery. And coming to, these are the types of combinatorial libraries. One is the scaffold based library, amino acids and amino benzophenone library, or benzodiazepine scaffold. The another one was backbone based library, in that we include carbohydrate or nucleic acid or protein. So the backbone will be the same for the designed library. And now, what are the methods employed in the synthesis of chemical libraries, in the process creating chemical libraries? So how are these chemical libraries prepared or synthesized? So one is split and mix method, split and mix synthesis method. The another one is parallel synthesis method. The first one is split and mix synthesis method, we'll be discussing about it. So here, as the name suggests, we need to separate and then mix up. In this method, ingredients are assembled on the surface of the beads. Now comes the role of beads. What are beads? These are nothing but microporous. Beads are nothing but microporous and solid support like materials, which you can see in the diagram. These are spherical, they are maybe microporous, and they are made of some polymer resins. They are made up of some polymer resins. You can write down, the beads are microporous and they are spherical and they are made up of polymer resins. Polymer resins, they act as solid supports. So they will be having very large surface area, and on which the synthesis of the compounds will occur. So in this method, ingredients are assembled on the surface of the beads or microparticles. In each step, beads from the last step are partitioned into new building block, and then several groups are added. So we use first set of beads on which we incorporate some compounds, and then we go for synthesis. And in the next step, the synthesized compounds on the beads will be partitioned onto the next bead, new beads, and then followed by addition of new building blocks. So here what we do is we split and then we mix in the successive steps, so that at the last we end up with the synthesis of a large library. So in each step, beads from the last step are partitioned into a new building block and several groups are added. This leads to the formation of new groups. The different groups of beads are recombined and separated. Combination, separation. Process is continuous until the next building block is added and until the desired library has been assembled. So this process will be continued until the design library has been assembled. So how does this work out? We'll see with an example. You will understand it in a much better way. So here you start with a bead. You start with three beads. Suppose A has a bead, B has a bead, B is a different chemical, A is a bead different chemical, and C is a different chemical. So A is linked to a bead, B is linked to a bead, and C is also linked to a bead. So how many monomers you have? A monomer, B monomer, C monomer. Three monomers you have. So now what we do is we combine them to give different combinations. A can react with B, A can react with A can react with B, and A can react with C. So I get a combination of A, AB, AC. And now B can react with B, B can react with A, and B can react with C. So I get three combinations, BA, BB, CB. And again I react in the same fashion. C can react with C, C can react with A, and C can react with B. So CA, CB, CC. So how many altogether? We get 9 dimers in the next step. What we are doing? We are mixing, and then followed by combination. So now AA can react with A, and AA can react with B, AA can react with C. So this is the part for A, and then followed by AB. AB can react with A, AB can react with B, AB can react with C. So this is the combination. And again, so here I lost some part of the diagram. Just a second. I'll check it once. Just hold on. So this diagram was partially written. I copied it somewhere. So here you can imagine that you get again here three combinations. This is AAA, AAB, AAC, followed by this one, AB. AB will be common for the three. ABA, ABB, ABC, and then followed by AC will be common. ACA, ACB, ACC. If you want, you can write down in the notes. ACC, ACA, ACB, ACC. And now BA, coming to BA. BA will be common for the first three set. BAA, BAB, BAC, followed by BB. BBB, BBC, BBA, BBB, BBC, and followed by BC. This set is not written. You can write down here. This will be BCA, BCB, BCC. And coming to the third set, as you can see, this is CAA, CAB, CAC, followed by CBA, CBB, CBC, and followed by the third set, which is not represented in the diagram. You can write down, that will be CCA, CCB, CCC, completely pure, CCC. So altogether what we are doing is we are getting a mixture of compounds in the second step, then we are separating them and then combining to get 27 different trimers. So in the first step, what we started with three monomers, we ended up with dimers. As you can see, A is a dimer, AB is a dimer. Here we end up with 27 trimers. This is 18 represented. Another 9 is you need to write on your own. So that will be 27 trimers. AAA is a trimer. So this is the technique involved in split and mix synthesis. And coming to the parallel synthesis, parallel synthesis. In separate vessels, different compounds are synthesized. So here, in separate vessels, different compounds are synthesized without remixing. In the earlier case, it was splitting and mixing. But here, there is no remixing. Different compounds synthesized. This is not like split synthesis because it requires a solid support. Over there, we use beads. Here, we use a solid support, or it can also be prepared in this solution form. So here, what do we use? We use a 96 well micro titer plate. So this is called 96 well micro titer plate. So it is commonly used for parallel synthesis. In each set, in each well, we get different compound. When during the process of synthesis, we get different compound. So parallel synthesis, in this, what do? We use separate vessels. We don't go for splitting and mixing combination, but different compounds are synthesized without remixing. It can be done without a solid support or in a solution form. It requires 96 well micro titer plates for the synthesis of parallel synthesis. So what is the method employed in parallel synthesis? There are two strategies. One is Hewton's T-back procedure, Hewton's T-back procedure. The another one is automated parallel synthesis. So what are these, will be studied. So in Hewton's T-back procedure, each T-back contains beads and is labeled. It looks more or less like a T-back, like with a mesh surface. That is the reason it is called as a T-back. So each tea bag contains beads and is labeled. Separate reactions are carried out on each tea bag. That is what is the significance of parallel synthesis from the split and mix synthesis. So combine tea bags for common reactions and workup. So what we need to do is, if the reactions are common for different compounds, then they can be clubbed up. And the workup procedure is nothing but, whatever the reaction we do, the following procedure after the synthesis of the product, the following procedure is called as workup procedure. So combine T-backs for common reactions or workup procedures. A single product is synthesized within each T-back. Different products are formed in different products. That is the meaning of single product is synthesized in T-back. So different products will obviously form in different T-backs. What is the use? Economy of effort. Combining tea bags for workup, cheap and possibly for any lab, manual procedure and is not suitable for producing large quantities of different products. Hewton tea bag procedure, it can be employed only for synthesizing small amount of compound, and it is a cheap method for synthesis and it is economical, but it cannot be used for synthesis of large number of compounds. So Hewton tea bags method, we can synthesize compounds in a pure form. Why? Because we are combining only in a step which has the reaction condition same and workup conditions are same. So that was about Hewton's T-back procedure. And coming to automated parallel synthesis, automated synthesizers are available. These are the instruments, automated synthesizers. Using the instruments, we will be going for synthesis. So automated parallel synthesizers are available with 42, 96, 124 plates. As we said, it utilizes micro titer plates. So here, the titer plates can be of 42 size, 96 well or 144 wells. So use beads or pins for solid phase support and then proceed with reaction and workup are carried out automatically. It means there is no intervention by the human or man. Same synthetic route used for each vessel, but different reagents, different products obtained per vessel. So here we synthesize different products. We produce different products in each vessel. The same will happen in the Hewton tea bag also, but this is not automated. It is manual. And it cannot be employed for synthesizing large number of compounds, whereas automated parallel synthesis can be employed for synthesizing large number of compounds. And what are the advantages? Advantages is biological evaluation will be easy after synthesis. Each compound is substantially pure. Why? Because we are not mixing it up. So substantially pure compounds are obtained. Biological evaluation is also easy. And then defined location will produce different compounds. See, the system, the computer system will tell us at which micro titer well, what is the compound obtained, what is the compound synthesized. So location of synthesis is also very easy to recognize, and disadvantages applicable only for particular libraries. So it is applicable only for the particular library synthesis only. So this is the basic introduction, the different types of combinatorial libraries or the chemical libraries, and the several strategies or techniques utilized in the synthesis of chemical libraries. So this is the introduction, and tomorrow we will be discussing about solid phase synthesis, which is a part of combinatorial synthesis.